We have a number of new diseases and also many re-emerging diseases that on the Threat Pathogens Committee for the United States that I've served on for about 40 years. We look at these re-emerging diseases as diseases that used to be controlled very effectively, or that we knew were there kind of sitting in the sidelines, but they were never of economic importance for us to get excited about. Those diseases now are becoming very serious and threaten the sustainability of our agricultural production. One of them that I'd like to discuss is Goss's wilt on corn. But before we do that, it's important that we recognize that if we have a problem, then there are certain steps that we need to go through if we're going to solve it. And so I've called these the five R's of correction or of problem solving. The first of those is to recognize that there's a problem. With Goss's wilt, it's not on most plant pathologists' lists because it's been considered a very wimpy disease, very minor disease of very little consequence, even though it costs us as much as a billion bushel of corn a year in our production. It's still a disease that is pretty much ignored by most of the plant pathologists, most of your agronomists, even though all you have to do is look around a corn field in the Midwest or even in the West now, anywhere in North America, and you'll see the incidence of this disease. So we need to recognize the problem. To solve it, we need to remove the source. We need to restrict the damage, compensate for that damage, remediate and have restitution. And then we really need to restore the system that was providing us the economic control of the particular disease, in this case, Goss's wilt. Goss's wilt as an economic problem for us is an induced disease brought to most parts of North America and the rest of the world through genetic engineering. Now, I mention that because there are three things that you have to have for a severe disease. You have to have a pathogen. In this case, the bacterial pathogen is Clavibacter michiganensis nebraskensis. You have to have susceptible corn hybrids, and that's what's been brought to us by genetic engineering, because in order to have expression of the genetically engineered traits, they had to go back to some of the more susceptible corn hybrids, germplasm lines, your A632 or B14, some of those lines that were more susceptible to Goss's wilt in order to have expression of the herbicide tolerance, Roundup Ready type characteristics, and the BT expression of the crytoxins. You also had to have an induced or a favorable environment for expression of the pathogen in those susceptible corn hybrids. We see that because of the increased susceptibility of the genetically engineered plants to many diseases, so that our corn used to be one of the healthiest plants that you could grow. Now it's a very wimpy plant. I can't remember in my graduate student days or even early professional days of ever recommending a fungicide on corn. We now see that fungicide applications are very common, and that's because when you apply glyphosate or with the genetic disruption of the genetic code, we see an increased susceptibility to many diseases that are requiring fungicide application. When we apply that fungicide, that you nullify six of the seven genetic characteristics for resistance to Goss as well. So we provide a more susceptible plant. We change the environment favorable for the pathogen, and we have a more pathogenic and increased virulence in our bacterial pathogen. So that I mentioned then that it's an induced disease economically, primarily brought to us through genetic engineering, even though it's the indirect route for it. Goss's wilt was formerly considered a very wimpy disease. We now see it with that induced intransigence, so that it costs us 1+ billion bushels of corn annually in the Midwest anytime we have a favorable environment for this disease to express itself. The moisture, the temperature conditions that are favorable for the disease, and we can guarantee pretty much that we're going to have Goss's wilt. Those conditions occur anytime except during a severe drought year. So our common production environment is very conducive now for this increased virulence pathogen with the more susceptible host for it. Goss's wilt is indigenous to North America. It's a disease that originated here. It's now been spread throughout the world on primarily through seed stocks. It can be seed-borne, water-borne, and wind-borne. It can also be bug-borne, carried as a contaminant on leaf-feeding insects and organisms that will pick up the bacterium and transmit it then, providing the wounding in the plant that used to be an absolute requirement for the disease. Now we see that when you apply the fungicide, that you're also providing the surfactant that provides a water film that makes it easy for this bacteria then to penetrate the stomata and natural openings in the leaf, so that it doesn't necessarily require the wounding that used to be required, because those physiological barriers are broken down with our other agricultural practices to ward off some of the other diseases. We also see a reduced nutrient density in our crops, so that it's a loss that we don't attribute a great deal to, but it has a tremendous impact when it comes to feeding our animals or to feeding our human population, because that's the source for our minerals, it's a source for our vitamins, and many other aspects of our nutrition are dependent on having a nutrient-dense food and feed available to us. We see then not only the losses from Goss's wilt through a lost production of the actual quantity of the crop, but you'll also see the infection will cause an ear drop, so that during harvest there's a lot of corn that's left on the ground. You can see this with the Roundup Ready crops, because in the next year in a corn-soybean rotation we end up with a lot of succotash because of those resistant corn plants that come up in the soybeans as a result of being resistant to the herbicide. We see a reduced nutrient density, a loss in market potential, because not only in the quantity of material, but the quality of material that is reduced, so that we have people, foreign markets that are becoming more particular, recognizing that our nutrient density and quality has deteriorated. Our seed quality is lessened. We have a lot more seedling diseases and germination problems from our genetically engineered seed that's contaminated with Goss's wilt. Warm, moist air favors disease development. Those are characteristics where we see very, very severe losses, and all of the tissues of the plant are susceptible to infection. This is a vascular disease, develops systemically, that critical period where you have a higher nutrient need is one that is especially reduced as a result of the vascular plugging from this pathogen. On the leaves, you'll see the lesions then will follow the vascular architecture of the host of the plant, and so you get long streaks of water-soaked lesions that will develop. They'll start from just a small spot, and then it spreads from those through the vascular system of the plant. You'll also see what we call a salting out of the bacteria. The bacteria is able to multiply and grow to the extent that it actually just seeps out of the tissue and appears as a salt-like deposition on those the outside of the tissue, and we call that a salting out effect, a typical characteristic of the Clavibacter nebraskensis pathogen, in this case the bacterial pathogen causing this disease. This then causes the plants to die or to prematurely age. These are symptoms essentially of just starvation. They're denied the water and the nutrients required to keep those tissues alive, and so you see the effects then overall on the plant. So it dies before maturity. That latter 30 days of maturity is very critical for nutrient density. That's when your protein, when your grain fill is maximized, and that's the period that's cut short with this particular disease. You have latent infection under less favorable conditions for disease expression, so that you can have a lot of seed infection from plants that may not be showing severe symptoms just because the bacterium hasn't reached the population density to cause the more visible symptoms to the plant. One of the things that's interesting with this disease is the effect of surfactants. And we find that much of our genetic resistance to Goss's wilt was actually based more on physical defenses to the pathogen than they were physiological. So that if you just look at the surfactants in the fungicides or in the Roundup and other herbicides that are used, those surfactants are there for a purpose, and that purpose is to increase penetration of the pathogen. They break down the cell walls, they break down the cuticle layer on the leaf, and they provide a water film then to maximize the penetration of the chemical. But that also provides an ideal environment for infection then by the pathogen, because you're creating a lot of wounding in those leaf tissues. You're overcoming that physical defense, so that just the surfactant alone that's used with the herbicides, which 95% of our plants will receive, of our genetically engineered plants, are the fungicides that are applied to control the other diseases that are induced, the leaf blights and leaf spots, those pathogens, that the surfactant alone will eliminate or nullify 6 of the 7 genetic sources of resistance to Goss's wilt. When the glyphosate is applied, it nullifies the seventh source because it shuts down those physiological defenses that the plant has. Even though we have genetic pathways that have been inserted to restore part of the shikimate pathway, they're not fully effective in restoring the resistance to Goss's wilt. The corn should mature at the ear stage. The ear should mature first and dry down, and then the rest of the corn will dry down after that, but the ear should dry first. The rest of the plant should maintain its integrity and its production throughout that full ear maturation stage, so that a normal, non-infected corn plant, you'll see the ears dry down and then droop and drop because of the weight of that kernel as it's fully developing and storing all of those nutrients for us. What we see with Goss's wilt is that you'll see the top part of the plant, that highly efficient photosynthetic part of the plant at the late stage of development and grain fill stage, that actually dries off and dies because the vascular system has been plugged and it's no longer getting the moisture and the nutrients that it requires. Other corn hybrids and other situations may die from the bottom up. And again, this depends on the environment and stage of infection, stage of disease development. So we see the two conditions. Usually with Goss's wilt, then the whole plant will finally die off 2 to 6 weeks before genetic maturity is established. The disease then has, the bacterium has an opportunity during that stress period to infect the kernels. They're not maturing, you're not getting the normal physical barriers to bacterial movement into the kernel. And so what we see in a lot of our corn seed is anywhere from 3 to as much as 30% actual seed infection by Goss's wilt. We can test for the disease serologically. Agdia has a serological test, so that if you're questioned whether it's Clavibacter nebraskensis or Goss's wilt, it's a matter of just putting some tissue in the sample bag and under the conditions there, and then a half hour or so you have a positive or a negative test. So it's easy to confirm. This isn't an easy pathogen to isolate. So if you're trying to plate it out in typical pathological procedures on an auger plate, it's not always an easy one to isolate and can be missed that way. So the serological tests provide a more precise, a little more accurate test. There is a 2% possibility of another organism reacting. It's also a bacterial pathogen, bacterial rot. We don't want either one of these organisms, and our resistance to both pathogens, both of these organisms, is sacrificed again for the genetic engineering process. But the serological test for Goss's wilt is 98%+ accurate, so it's a very excellent test, simple to use and mobile, so you can take it with you, do the testing in the field. And looking at control for Goss's wilt, we really have three strategies that we can use. We can, because those are the three things that have to coalesce before we have severe disease. And that's, we can look at the plant, we can look at the environment, and we can look at the pathogen, and those things that would make those environments or those conditions for each one of those three factors then less conducive for the disease from a control standpoint. I've also already mentioned when we look at strategy one would be focusing on the plant. There is good resistance to this disease, although we find that that resistance now has been compromised somewhat because we've also seen the increase in virulence of the pathogen. So that a lot of some of the physiological resistance isn't as effective as it used to be 40 years ago, but it's still a consideration. The problem there is that if we have good resistance to Goss's wilt, we have a reduced expression of the genetic engineering traits, so that we get more damage from the herbicides or less effectiveness of the crytoxins from an insecticidal standpoint with good resistance to Goss's wilt. Hybrid selection certainly is still a major factor, and we see large differences, a broad range, even in our genetically engineered plants as far as susceptibility and ability to tolerate this disease. Our strategy two would focus on the environment. We know that we need optimum plant nutrient availability for resistance to any of our diseases and stress conditions. All of those stress conditions tie right back to specific nutrients. So that if we're going to look at changing the environment or having an environment that's less conducive for Goss's wilt, we need to have optimum nutrition. We need to have a balanced nutrition that provides those nutrients at the time and in the tissues that are developing so that they can maintain the resistance. Even if you have genetic resistance, that genetic resistance is dependent on the nutrient support so that it can be expressed physiologically. We need to prevent overwintering survival of the inoculum. This is a disease, an organism that isn't a good soil competitor. It doesn't survive well in the soil once the residue is decomposed. It has the ability to, by prior colonization and some antibiotic production that it has, to slow down colonization by a lot of other organisms. And that's one reason why your genetically engineered stubble doesn't decompose as rapidly, as you have some of these organisms that have colonized those tissues that slow down the colonization by your rapid decomposing type organisms. So we want to decompose those residues as quickly as possible. And under no-till, that means that we need to have organisms that can essentially overcome the antibiotic characteristics and physiological characteristics of these plants that have been pre-colonized by these re-emerging type of pathogens. Crop rotation becomes important in that elimination of that overwintering survival on it. Dr. Ann Vitivar was asked, well, how's the best way to control this disease? And there were some shocked farmers when she said, have you ever heard of a plow? Well, we used to would bury that residue. Again, that would increase the decomposition of those tissues that were infected. And the clavibacter would essentially die out because it's not able to compete then with the natural soil microflora that we had. We need to make sure that we have clean irrigation water. That used to be almost 100% source of Goss's wilt when we saw an economic loss. That's why it was limited to those few counties in Nebraska and eastern Iowa. It was because those were the ones that were in a dry area where you had irrigation going on. The rest of the Midwest relied on rain-fed conditions. Starting out with clean seed used to be effective, at least when Goss's Wilt would move into a cornfield. It would usually be late in the season and our losses would be minimized. It's pretty much impossible for us to have clavibacter-free seed now because of the extent of this disease. It's become an endemic disease throughout North America, and the probability of having completely clean seed is pretty remote. Strategy three is focusing on the pathogen. In plant pathology, we used to emphasize that you needed to look at all three, because it's only when you have all three of those components in the environment, the plant, the environment, and the pathogen, that all coalesce at the same time that you have disease. In plant pathology, with chemical agriculture and chemical disease controls, sometimes we forget about the plant and the environment and think that we can do it all by eradicating the pathogen or knocking its levels down. And certainly that's one of the things that we need to focus on, especially with Goss's Wilt. That becomes very important. So that when we focus on the pathogen with Goss's Wilt, we need to focus on those things that will reduce its virulence. That becomes a nutritional factor. Biological approach for controlling this disease, either through competition or through direct reduction in its activity, the biological controls. We do have antibiotics that would be possible. They're not economic for a field crop. The biological control has one of the greatest potentials for controlling Goss's Wilt, because we've minimized our ability in modifying or in managing the plant and the environment, so that biological control with an organism that can compete and can suppress the activity of the clavibacter becomes a very viable option for us. And one of those that we're seeing with some very excellent success has been the bioimprove type of an approach. I've worked in the looking at biocontrols for many of our pathogens for my 55-year career. We need to still focus on all three strategies. We need to focus on the plant, have clean seed, have as high a level of resistance as we can in that plant. We need to have optimum nutrition to make that environment for the clavibacter as least conducive as possible and as favorable for the plant to maintain its resistance. We need to eliminate the alternate host, get our residue decomposition, and then we have that extra whammy that we can use in the biological controls to actually attack the pathogen itself, to suppress both its virulence and its ability to develop within the plant by prior colonization and essentially being king of the hill. If you get there first, then the pathogen as opportunities is greatly reduced, so that if we use these strategies, we can sustain our agricultural production, improve our nutrient density, and provide that abundance of food and feed that our society needs to sustain itself and to progress.